So interesting to really take a notice of the importance of mothers in a home. I was very happy. I saw some of our church members who really take time and gave their mothers, or their wives for that matter, a time to celebrate last week on a Mother's Day. I would really encourage you. You can never take for granted appreciating your moms day in and day out. They're a blessing of God, and we ought to honor them. And everyone said, I'd like to share two thoughts this morning, and one is our duty, and number two, the colorful life of a mom. And this is born out of what I have seen that we ought to really do and change, because in our generation today, we have seen an atmosphere of rebellion inside the house rather than a culture of submission. Nowadays, we've been so, exposed by the television. We have adapted so many ways that are purely rebellious in nature, and it has been adapted inside our homes, and our culture is literally, on a move to change it. It used to be when we are not yet that much of exposed to the negative side of the Western influence. We have our own, like for example, our music. We have the Kundiman, the all-time favorite of our culture. Now, the new generation doesn't even know what Kundiman is. Sa Bisaya, Kundi? Man siguro na. We have no idea. Now, if you ask the young people about their music, they'll talk about jazz, pop, rock. They can talk about contemporary music. They talk about soul, blues, black music, white music, red music, yellow music. All kinds of stuff. And most are pretty much on the West. Now, there are many things that the West have given us very, very good. But some of it, we have to really make sure we are not influenced to do the wrong things. And one is the culture of rebellion. I do what I do because I want what I want, and this is what I like, and this is my life. No one can change that, and that is wrong. Especially so when you are in a family, inside a home, and you're still young. The Bible said in Exodus 20 verse 12, honor your father and your mother so that you may live long in the land the Lord your God is giving you. In the book of Deuteronomy 5:16 of Deuteronomy, honor your father and your mother as the Lord God has commanded you, so that you may live long and that it may go well with you in the land the Lord your God is giving you. God made a commandment, and he said, honor your father and mother. For the sake of our emphasis for the mother, or for the mothers, honor your mother. Now, honoring your mother is not done like, what the corporate world has taught us. The corporate have this agenda and teaching the growing up supervisor, and they would share, that authority and honor is earned. Just as respect must be earned so that you can get the following of your subordinates or the people behind you. You have to show them that you're respectable, you're honorable, that you're the type of person that they can really trust. You have to give them time to know who you are, and to really give their full attention and cooperation with you as you earn their respect. But in the scripture, it does not say that mothers need to earn respect to their children. It's a command of God for us to honor our mother and father. And for this emphasis, our mothers. The Bible did not qualify, you honor your father, your mother when they are good. and you dishonor them when they are wicked. The Bible did not say, well, honor your mother when they are righteous and forget about them when they are wicked on their behavior. God never said that. The Bible only said one statement: honor your father and mother. For the sake of your mother, and the Bible says it does not need time or element for you for a mother to earn respect. It's an innate thing. It's a part of life. Just like God. God does not need to earn respect from us. The moment we know who God is in our lives, we should automatically honor Him as the creator of our lives. The created cannot react the way they think they could to the creator. Just as a mother is created of God for humanity to come out born of a woman, reveals as well the requirement that humanity must recognize in honoring the mothers of their lives. None and no human being has come out of this house or of this earth, of this country, of this nation without passing through a mother. Even if it was what we can call a test tube baby, they still have to be inoculated inside a mother's womb. The child must grow according to what God has designed for it. And because that is the case, the Bible said, we must and we should, and not justify whatever reason, and simply follow what God said, and that is to honor our moms. It's so sad that many individuals, especially the youth of our time, have developed the attitude of qualifying whether that woman or that mother or this mother is honorable or not honorable. The Bible simply said, when you're a mom, you should be honored. And if you're a child and you have a mother, you should honor your mother, irregardless of who she is. Because that is what the Bible said. God has never spoken in the scripture and said, well, you must honor your mother. If God simply said, honor your father and your mother. There are three words that we can use in honoring them. Three simple words, and I hope this will be part of our growing up process. In Ephesians 6:1-3, the Bible said, children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. The first word that God used, children, what are we supposed to do? Obey our parents in the Lord. Parents are assumed to be following God. Parents are assumed, in the context of the Ephesian church, was in submission to the will of God for their lives, that they would not tell their kids to do something that would not be pleasing to God. And the Bible says, kids, obey your mothers or your fathers. And the word obey there isn't the word hupako or hupuko, H-U-P-A-K-O-U-O, which means to listen attentively. By implication, it means you are conforming and you are going to listen to the command or to the one in authority above you. You are going to listen with the intention of obeying. You're not just listening without obeying, you're listening to obey. And the Bible said, kids or children, obey your parents in the Lord. Now, part of the reasons why some kids don't listen to their parents is really how they brought up their kids when they're young. One of the advantages of studying is that when we were having our first child, me and my wife started to buy books of how to become a better parent for parenting. And I have looked at Asian culture, Western culture. But the beauty about these books that we bought were all Christians. So it really doesn't matter whether you're an Asian or a West or an Eastern culture, because the Bible is the standard way of living. And one of the books we read by Tim LaHaye taught us about teaching the children of a one call only. You teach the child one call that he would obey or listen to you. So we did what the book said, and the book said you start with a game, and that you try to hide and seek. You call your child's name very softly, and your child must really listen very carefully that what he hears is his name. And that when he is called, he must run at the first call. So what we did that and have rewards. And we have this, we bought this chocolate that looked like coin that is covered with gold stuff. So we did that as their reward. So we ran up to the second floor, and the kids were downstairs. So we said, there were three of them at the time. And we would call their names softly, and they had to listen at the second at the ground floor and hear their name being called. And when they hear their name called once, they must run. And when they hear it only once, we give them a reward of this gold coin chocolate. But if we have to call them twice before they could come, we have to confiscate the chocolate that they have in their hands. And by the end of the game, we would see how many amongst them have so many chocolates in their hand and those who have few. And that would tell them that they have not listened to their mom or dad very, very sensitively. So that has been part, you know, we did that for a week, so the kids would have a developmental process of being called once. And then we started to apply the principle, and we told them, we only called you once, and once we call you, you must go and do whatever mom and dad tells you. And that has become part of it. And then we said, if we have to call you twice, thrice, or four times, you will have to go through physical therapy. In Bisaya, we call that pite. And because of that, and you know, please parents, if you are going to be a good parent, and you tell your child that, you know, there's a rule that you have to go through a physical therapy, you must adapt the physical therapy whether you like it or not, or else they would not listen to your authority. That your word doesn't mean anything. Some parents, they would tell their kids, I will spank you. And they would say that 1,000 times and never spank the child. So would the child really listen to their authority? Of course not, because the parents were not able to, you know, sustain, prove the value of their authority, of their words towards the child. So if you call your child once and sometimes, or not probably sometimes, it's really the parents who have taught their children to listen to them 3 to 5 times before a child would come. For example, the mother would say, Wayne, come here. And then Wayne is just there but would not say anything. So the mom would say again, Wayne! Still would not respond. And then the mother would be mad, Wayne! Then Wayne would say, ah, I'm here. And that's it. The next time, mom would call again, Wayne! Won't listen. Second, Wayne! Won't listen. Third time again with a high pitch, Wayne! Oh, ma, I'm here. What happened? Well, we trained the child to listen to us on the third call. Some of us, we taught our children to listen when we have the higher do octave of the notes of the keys of the piano before they listen to us. You first call them in the lower octave, Wayne. Second octave, Wayne. Third octave, Wayne! And that sometimes is how we, you know, instructed them to respond to our call. But really what is important is to train them to listen to one call only. So we train a child. We tell them, if I call you, you have to come at one call only, not twice. And what I do with our family, if I have to call them twice, I have to tell them, anak, if I call you the second time, you know what goes with it. Spunky friend. Spunky friend is a small belt conveyor stuff that we bought on a parenting seminar, Christian parenting seminar, that they sold, that is, they said, a biblical use for a rod of correction. So we bought that and we called it spunky friend. A friend of those who does not listen. And this spunky friend will fellowship with the butt of anyone who refused to listen to mom and dad. So whenever we say twice or thrice already and they haven't really heeded our call, spunky friend will visit the bat. And sometimes it will make a history and leave a mark that they did have a fellowship at the time. For what purpose? To instill discipline, to instill the authority of the mom or the father for that effect. Parents, I would really encourage you, impose your authority because you're the mother or you're the father, and not because you wanted to abuse your child. You train up a child, the Bible says, in the way that he should go, and when he is grown up, he will not depart from it. Let's teach them to honor authority over their lives. Let's allow them to see the beauty of having authorities being honored and the consequences or effects of having to honor the authorities they have. So kids, the Bible said we are to obey our parents. And parents, I would really encourage you, teach your kids how to obey. And all parents would say, and all the children who will obey their parents, even when they are old, would say, hi, Lord, wake up this side in Jesus' name. Secondly, the Bible said in Ephesians 6, children, obey your parents in the Lord. For this is right, honor your father and mother, which is the first command with a promise. Second is the word honor. The word honor in the Greek has the idea of revering or giving value. In Proverbs 15 verse 20, the Bible said, 15:20, a wise son brings joy to his father, but a foolish man despises his mother. Proverbs 19:26, he who robs his father, drives out his mother, is a son who brings shame and disgrace. Proverbs 23:22, listen to your father who gave you life, and do not despise your mother when she is old. My wife took some time last week to explain Proverbs 23:22 about not despising your mother when she is old. Because when you were so young, an infant, your strength was your mother's arm. Your guide was your mother's arm. And then now that you have grown up and your mom is now so old, the very strong hands that took care of you when you were so little has now shriveled and has aged. And because of that, it has changed her physically. Now she is not as strong as she was. Now she is not able to do what she used to do. But still, does not change the position that she is your mother and you are her child. And sometimes because our old mother becomes affected with their age, sometimes they tend to be over and over and over, very repetitive on what they were asking and keep on asking the same question. Even right after asking the same question, they ask the same question. One time, I was we were in Dumaguete, and I happened to meet my auntie, my wife's aunt, who was the sister of my mother-in-law, and she's probably 80 years old, and she's already on the stage where she keeps on asking the same thing. When she first saw me, said, "Oi, kumusta?" Said, "Ante, kumusta?" And she said, "Kumusta na ka? What's your name?" "Noel, ante." "Oh, how many kids do you have?" I said, "I have 4. "What's their name?" I said, "Their names." And then after I said that, she said, "How many kids do you have?" I said, 4. "What's their name?" So I said it again. And then after that, we chat a little bit. And then he said, "What's your name?" I said, "Noel, ante." "Oh, how many kids do you have?" I said, 4. "What's their name?" So I have to go back all over again. And sometimes you feel like it's tiring to just talk to them. But please understand, if you don't treat them well now, one day when you're old, you'll be worse. So right now, we must learn to treat them with honor. Treat them with what? And not just, you know, put them aside or despise them. One of the things we did, and probably we will do this now as a family tradition, I decided last week to tell my wife to, after the Mother's Day, that we will go home to the province and we will celebrate Mother's Day with her mother, because she's the only one amongst our relationships that has still a grandmother. So the only remaining grandmother, because my parents are all dead, on my wife's side, Mama San is still alive, and the only grandmother living. So I want my children to honor their grandmother. So I told my wife, call your siblings and tell them that we're going to go home and we will celebrate Mother's Day. And then my wife took that initiative and called up her siblings and give them assignment. You bring this food, I'll bring this food. And then, in short, we were able to put them together just overnight. And we arrived in Dumaguete, and by the evening time, the food were all ready. We ate together. And after the eating time, we had a service. We had a praise and worship. My daughter led the worship. She took the guitar. The whole family were there. The siblings were there. The grandchildren were there. We were having good time worshiping the Lord. And after worshiping God, my wife took the time and shared about what the Bible says in honoring your mother. And then all of the siblings were there with her. And then after that, I asked the siblings to share, including the in-laws, to share on how Mama Sani was a blessing to us. So each one of them shared a thought about, you know, what they can remember about Mama Sani and what Mama Sani did. And all of the siblings, likewise, of my wife, shared about how Mama Sani took the responsibility, because my wife was only 5 years old, or grade five, a second year high school when Papa Pedro died. So she literally took the responsibility on her own in bringing the kids, graduate them to college, and did her responsibility. So each one of them shared and really give some time. And after all of the siblings, the in-laws, all in-laws, share with Mama Sani how Mama Sani has been a blessing to you. So each one of us shared. I started it, and the ball rolled all over. And then after we shared, I asked all of the grandchildren, all grandchildren, I'd like you to volunteer, tell your grandma about what you think, what you feel, how blessed you are for her life. There are kids that cried, you know, Mama Sani, you've been good to me, with the teary-eyed effect. It was good. You know the beauty of that? Our children will put that in their memory bank and remember the importance of honoring their mother. And probably so, from this day on forward, every year, we will go home and honor our mother, because I think Mama Sani is 84 years old, and we will just would like to give her a good memory on the remaining years of her life and enjoy it with us honoring her, you know, every year, the Lord willing. And I share that because one of the ways to honor her is really bringing a time where you just gather and for the purpose of honoring her presence, of her being a mom to you, and not despise her. And you would appreciate how it would have an impact, not only to your mother, but likewise to your children's children. And I would encourage you, if you have not done that, please think about an opportunity where you can do it. You can have your own style of doing it. But what we wanted for you to share is the idea of honoring your mother, so that the children will follow you and do the same. And that the respect level, the authority, and what the Bible says, that we're supposed to honor our parents, especially our moms, would be done according to the scripture. So how do we express our honoring our moms? Well, we obey them. Number two, we honor them. And thirdly, we respect them. We do what? The opposite of respect is disrespect. And disrespecting them, whether in your presence, in their presence or in their absence, is still disrespectful. And the Bible tells us that we must learn to respect our parents, or especially our moms, for they were given to us by God. You see, this is one of the things that you cannot choose in your life. You can choose what you want to wear. You can choose your husband. You can choose your wife. But you cannot choose your mother. And you must learn to appreciate that. Again, not because they're good or bad, but because they're your mother. And that's enough reason for you to make a firm commitment to follow God's instruction in honoring your mom. And all children who will respect their mothers would say,
amen.
Praise God. Three words: obey, honor, and respect. Let's talk about the colorful life of a mother. I would say colorful because in the scripture, the description of mothers are not what we would see it on our time. Some mothers, especially in our culture, by the time they hit 65, 70, some of them, they think they are already retired and they don't need to do anything and they would just not do anything. But still, to the most of our grandparents, even if they're old, they never stop working or doing things for the Lord. And that, my friend, is a valuable thing. Because in the scripture, in the book of Ezekiel 19 verse 10, this is how the mom or the woman was described. 19 verse 10 of Ezekiel, your mother was like a vine in your vineyard, planted by the water. It was fruitful, full of branches, because of the abundant water. The mother was described as a vine in a vineyard who was fruitful because the vineyard was planted beside the streams of water. They're not idle. They're not busybodies. They are productive to the very end of their lives. I can remember my grandmother, si Lola Minyang. Almost every year we would go home when we were younger, elementary days, every year to Leyte, and visit Lola. And Lola would always be the first one to wake up in the morning, open the windows, open the door, and my grandfather would be the one to buy the bread in the market. And by the time we all wake up, the bread is on the table. Lola is done already for the breakfast. And now waiting at the gate for the saop to bring all of the goodies of the products of her land. Until she died, she did not die doing nothing. She died of old age, but still working like what she used to do. And that is what the Bible's description of a mother. Their mind never stops. It doesn't prose in time. When you hit 80, your mind will just... No. The Bible describes the mother as like a vine planted beside the streams of water, and they keep bearing fruit. Pastor Shoni shared about the Proverbs 31 woman, or lady, or the mother of Proverbs 31, in verse 10 to verse 27 or 31, and talked about how a woman, a mother at that, a wife for that matter, has really been a blessing to his community, to his household, and most importantly, to her own family. And that description literally fits a woman in the scripture that is normal, living actively, and never cease to care for her family. And that, I would say, is a very colorful one because they just don't stop. They just do not stop. They keep on doing what they know they should do and they think they should do, and they just do it as like living on a regular life. When we were on our cellar one time, we were talking about how would it look like if we take the wife's role in the house. What do we do if we shift for one day? Our wife will go to work and the husband will stay in the house and do what the mothers are doing. And one of the sailors did this. I think if I will do the job of my wife, this is how it would look like. I would be washing clothes. At the same time, I'll be washing clothes beside where I cook. And then she would be... And then when the child would be crying, she would do like this with his feet. with the swing of the child on it. And it's done simultaneously. And the mothers don't even complain. The husband who came from work, arrived in the house, complained, "Where's my food?" And the mom would simply run and get the food, put it on the table, and feed the hungry monster that's about to eat. But the wife, they just do what they need to do. There was one time, one sir Lord on her testimony, and he said, "My wife went with her family, so I was left in the house with my two kids. My wife said, 'This is where the diaper is. This is where the milk is. This is where you go and you need to do when the child do this.' So he kind of looked at that. Simple. So he was left by himself, and then the child began to cry. Said, 'No problem.' My wife said, 'Check the diaper. There's a poo.' Changed diaper. He removed, thrown the diaper, and then he forgot to wash it. He just put on a diaper. And the child still cry. Said, 'No problem. There's milk.' And the child still cry. And the child won't stop. So she called the wife. The child won't stop crying. What's the problem? I changed diaper already. I put milk already on his mouth, and she's still crying. And the wife said over the phone, 'Did you wash her butt?' 'Oh, okay.' And then after doing the diaper, he realized that it was already lunchtime. The older boy needed to eat. So the boy said, 'Dad, let's eat.' He said, 'Okay.' He went to the kitchen and found out that there was nothing cooked. But there was a list of instructions. You get the rice on the side, there's a fish on the rep, and all instruction. So he tried to do what the instruction said and did it. And then the child was just there standing, 'Dad, I am hungry.' So what he did, he said, 'Forget about cooking. What do you want, son? It's you and me. You want chicken? We'll buy chicken.' So the child said, 'I want chicken.' So they went out and eat. Dinner came, because 2 days the wife will not be there. And then the child said, 'Dad, I want to eat.' The father said, 'No problem, son. It's the two of us. Where do you want to eat?' 'I'm not going to cook.' Because he realized if he's going to cook, he has to wash the plates, he has to wash the dishes, and including those pots that he has to clean. He said, 'Why bother?' And the wife arrived the next 2 days and found out the rice wasn't touched. The fish was still on the rep, and the wife said, 'What happened? You did not eat?' 'We ate.' 'I just don't want to be bothered with the stuff, you know.' And after that, on his testimony, he said, 'Now I appreciate my wife, how good she is in what she does in our home.' I hope we do all of that to our wives." And all the husband would say, "Amen." Only one. Husband, repent. The real mother takes responsibility, and it's part of their life. They don't complain about it. It's just a routine. Secondly, real moms sacrifice. Real moms do what? In 1 Kings 3:27, the Bible says, "Then King gave his ruling. 'Give the living baby to the first woman. Do not kill him. She is the mother.'" This is a story where two mothers were trying to fight over a child, because the real mother, when she was asleep, had the other mother's child switch, because her child is dead. And then when the real mother wake up, she found that the child beside her was dead. And when she checked it out, it was not her child. So she looked at the other side and she found that it was her child. So they have a dispute. So they went to the king and got it and had the ruling. And then King Solomon said, "Okay, so that there would be no fight, let's cut the child in half. You get a head, she gets the tail." The mother, one who is not the real mom, said, okay, that's fair, so no one will fight. But the real mom said, no, please don't kill the child. He's yours. Then Solomon said, give the child to the one who said, don't kill the child, give it to the other one. She is the real mother. Real moms sacrifice for their family. Real mom does it not because they would like to have a hero's welcome one day. They do it because that's their norm. That's who they are. Instead of buying clothes for themselves, they buy educational books for their children. They would rather buy stuff for the children than buying things for themselves when funds are not available. Thirdly, mother's colorful life is shared with their husband's responsibility. And on responsibility, I'd like to share two things. One, mother and father share responsibility in disciplining their child. We parents have the responsibility in making sure that the child grows up in the admonition and in the fear of God, including the discipline that is required in order for the child to grow properly. The Bible teaches that every child has a bent. The word bent in the Hebrew is the inclination to do wrong. And every child has that. And the only way for that bent to be corrected is for the rod of correction to be applied so that the child does not continue on with the wrong thing. And that is what parents' responsibility needed to do. In Deuteronomy 21 verse 18, the Bible said, 21:18, if a man has a stubborn and rebellious son who does not obey his father and mother, will not listen to them when they discipline him, his father and mother shall take hold of him, bring him to the elders at the gate of his town. Proverbs 29:15, the rod of correction imparts wisdom, but child left to himself disgraces his mother. So it's our responsibility to make sure the child is going to grow disciplined. I don't know if you have noticed this, but some mothers who have adopted children are more intensely in love with their child than those biological mothers on their own. Probably because, you know, it's a gift, it's an answered prayer of God for them, that they really treasure the child, that they do what the example we have last week of a wish of a child saying, I wish I have a mother who would always say yes, whatever I want. Sure not. When the mother said, nah, mommy, I'd like to borrow your phone. The mom said, sure, no. Mommy, can I go to my friend's house and not return? The mother said, sure, no. Can I borrow your car and drive it by myself to SM and never return? The mother said, sure, no. And the daughter realizes that, you know, having a mother only giving you whatever you want does not make a good life. So when she was awakened with the dream, she realizes the mother she had was the perfect one for her, who disciplined her, who would tell her what she needed to do, and, you know, live a life that is pleasing to the Lord. It's our responsibility to discipline the child. We do not relinquish that responsibility. Mother and father have that shared responsibility in making sure the child grows and in the fear of the admonition of God. Second responsibility, and I would like to emphasize this because this is countercultural. The Bible tells us in Deuteronomy 22:15 of Deuteronomy, then the girl's father and mother shall bring the proof that she was a virgin to the town elders at the gate. Now, the story behind was that in their time, the mother and the father are responsible in turning their child or their daughter in marriage or in matrimony, but the child, the daughter, must be a virgin. And it was the responsibility of the parents, the father and the mother, to make sure that their daughter is presented as a virgin and not have had a premarital sex before they turn it over to the husband. And when they found out, when the parents are found out that their child has been given to marriage and the child was not a virgin, the parents can be held liable. Now, what does that mean to us? On our times right now, culturally talking about, there's so many stuff that is going on. And some kids have really this wrong understanding that they have the right to do whatever they want. It's their life. Well, the Bible never says that that should be. As long as your child is in your responsibility or upon your responsibility, or their growing up process is on your shoulder, you must preserve them to the upcoming man of their life. Kids, if you play around or fool around with premarital sex, you don't know how hurtful it is to your mom and dad. You don't know how much it affects them. When you destroy what could have been a gift to your husband-to-be and not fool around with someone who just would like to experiment on you and try you out if you're like a shoe that fits them. The Bible tells us that the parents will have to bring the sheet that the husband and wife on their honeymoon night, it will be given to the parents, and the parents will hold it and show as a proof that their daughter was indeed a virgin when he was given to a man for marriage. I would encourage, please, young people, do not abuse your parents' liberality on you in giving you liberty to go with your friends. Don't abuse their trust on your boyfriend or on your girlfriend. They trust you, and I hope you honor that trust. Sakit sa inahan nga makadungog sila ilang anak dili na birhen, and only to find out one day that their daughter is pregnant and she's not even, you know, a graduate in college. It is going to be so painful that sometimes they kill an individual because of the pain they take in knowing that their child has been abused, maligned, or probably taken advantage. And I would encourage, please, young people, do not fool around or play around with sex in Jesus' name. And all young people would say, you want sex? Get married. You can do sex every second if you want, but in context of marriage. And you can get married when you are fully grown up. You understand the responsibility that God requires for you to become a husband or for you to become a wife. But you don't fool around with the things that God calls as holy. And all the youth again would say, Pastor, you said this is Mother's Day. Why are you talking about us? Well, it's part of the joy and the pain of a mother when they see their kid go through that. I would really encourage parents to get involved in the day-to-day affair of your children, especially if they're teenagers or even if they're already working. Please know who they're going with and get to know the people who they are with. And get their telephone numbers and talk to them and tell them, if I trust you, please don't destroy this trust. And all parents would say, we have responsibility to take care, especially our daughters, to preserve them and bring them to the matrimony, a virgin, preserved for the glory of God. Fourthly, the joys and the pain of mothering. You know, mothers enjoy seeing their kids grown up. Even if their daughter is already 40 years old or 38 years old, they look at their child as, baby, how is my baby? And the baby is already 38 years old. Sometimes the mother would say, can I carry you, my baby? And the baby is 250 pounds. On their mind, the child is still their child, and they would like to play with their child the way they see it. In my 27 years of ministry, I had numerous weddings done. And I can say this, mothers are the most sensitive when it comes to weddings. I have seen fathers act like so much composed and don't feel anything when their daughter is being brought to the altar in the processional on the wedding day. Very few moms I have seen who maintain their composure. Most of the mothers, during the processional, what do? times worse, like a person who had gone through a stroke. They could not contain their emotion that their child is now going to get married and leave them. You know what most parents do now? They would tell their new son-in-law or daughter-in-law, said, you know what? You stay in our home so you can save money for rent. Why do they do that? Because they still want their child in their compound, in their eyes, within their perimeter of security. Moms, when your child or your daughter or son get married and they're mature enough, let them go. And everyone said. The Bible said in Genesis 2:24, for this reason a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and they will become one flesh. That verse is repeated in Ephesians 5:31. For this reason a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. The Bible said when a man and a woman decide to get married, they should be starting on their own. And all parents would have to support that and will say. Some parents would say like this, what will happen to you if you stay with us? Your room is air conditioned. But if you go with your husband, or I'm sure you're starting up and it will be hot in your room. Some parents would even say, how's my apo? He will be under a very hot environment, but if he will stay here, he's in an air-conditioned room. Excuse me, don't worry, your grandchild will not die just because there's no air-conditioning unit. And all parents would say, give your daughter, your son, a good room to start their lives. I don't marry people who cannot stand on their own. The first thing we talk about is their budget. When they are going to tell me they want to get married, we ask them, how much do you earn? Can you really provide and supply the needs of your spouse or of your family? If they could not do it, say, why will you be marrying someone? Well, because, you know, she's already pregnant. I'm sorry. You know, marrying is not the answer for anybody who gets pregnant. We would tell them, just because she's pregnant doesn't mean you're supposed to marry her. It simply shows that you were unruly and you sin against God, but solution is not marrying the person. Ah, Pastor, what will happen to our name? It will not change. It will still be the same last name. But my daughter is pregnant. She needs to have a husband. Why? So that she can kill herself? When a child is too young to get married, she might be 20, 19 years old, big body already, you know, a body of a lady. Doesn't mean she has a mind of a woman. Wherever we go, they would look at my daughter as 25, 28 years old because of her size. And they would be shocked to learn that she's just 15 years old. So I would tell them, you know, don't be fooled around by her body. She's big. She's huge. If you want to look at it that way. But she's still playing with Jolens. Don't worry. She's harmless. Now, I share that because when a child or your son or daughter really would like to get married, make sure that they can stand on their own. If they cannot stand, do not encourage them to be married. And everyone said, no more. I would never encourage any two boyfriend and girlfriend like to get married simply because the girl is pregnant. It's never the answer. On my experience, those people I married 21 years and below have separated. That only tells you that they're not really mature enough to recognize the responsibility. Not all, of course, but I would say more than half of the 21-year-old below that I married, between 18 and 21, they end up separating. They just don't know the responsibility. They don't know what it is to be married. That's why I enjoy marrying people when they're mature already. They understand what it is. They enjoy the fruit of their labor and not trying to know what it is to be, you know, a father and a mother. And that's why as parents, it might be painful for us to see our kids move on and take a new family on their own. But that's part of the cycle of life. We support it. We give them the right tools to grow up with. But we accept that part of the joys of mothering is likewise seeing your daughter or your son leaving you and build their own family. And all parents would say, the bottom line is this. When we honor our father and mother, especially for Mother's Day, the Bible said on Ephesians 6, there are two promises that will happen. Ephesians 6 verse 3 said, that it may go well with you, and number two, that you may enjoy long life on earth. First promise, everything will go well with you. Second promise of God, if you honor your father and mother, is that you will have long life with the joy of living it. If you want a fruitful life, honor your parents. If you want a long life and enjoy that long life, honor your parents. And everyone said, let's give God a wonderful hand of praise. Father, we thank you, Lord, for your word today in Jesus' name. You can never take for granted your mom's role for your life. We would encourage you. Honor her every time you see her. In Jesus' name. Say to the person beside you, honor your mother. And never forget to honor her. Amen. One more time, let's give God a hand of praise. Thank you, Lord. We give you praise.
Can we go out and buy Magnum ice cream at SM?
SM? Dito natagikan, anak. You have not mentioned about Magnum ice cream. Dili na lang ta sa balay na ako gi-prepare nga food, vegetable.
Everyone's eating Magnum ice cream. You're so cagey, Mom. I don't like vegetables. I'll not eat dinner. I wish I have a mom who always gives what I want.
Hello, Jamie. Yes, I hear you. Yes, I want all the transactions done today. Yes, I want you to have all the papers on my table, all right? Yes, I'm coming. Wait a second, okay? Bye. Sweetie, listen to me. Mom's gonna be very, very busy today, but here's the money. Just, you know, have Yaya with you. You buy whatever you like. You go to SM, buy Magnum, whatever it is called. Just have fun, all right? Okay, Mom, let's go.
No,
bye!
Yay! Yaya, let's go now, let's go to
SM. Katsutra!
I have plenty. Nice shoes, beautiful dresses, plenty of money. I can buy what I want. But it's not the same without mommy. I wish I have a mom who will always be with me.
What happened? Why are you playing? Come here, Anna, so you could rest before the practice. Come here.
But mom, I want to play with my friends.
Oh, anak, come on, anak. You sit down. You have to rest before the practice. Oh, my God. Oh, anak. Oh, it's time to start the practice. Oh, come on. Let's fall in line. Come on, anak. Come on. Oh, anak.
It's full in line!
Lord, I wish I have a Kuma who just allows me to do what I want to do.
Mom, excuse me, can I borrow your cell phone so I can play games?
Sure, yeah.
Mom, can I eat chocolates?
Sure enough. Go and check it from the ref.
Mom, can I go to Ben's house and never come back?
Sure enough.
Mom, can I borrow your car and drive to SM by myself?
Sure enough. Sure enough. Sure enough. Sure enough.
You're dreaming, Hana.
Mom, I've been with so many moms in my dream, Mom, but I never felt complete as I am with you now.
I love you too, Anna.
And brother, you love us with a love that's like no other. It's through your love that I discover
there's nothing like a mother, nothing stronger than a mother's love. I don't always get to tell you. Let me take the time to say Happy Mother's Day.
Grandma, you're the one that does everything for me. There will be no time that I have ever wanted. No, you still live till the end.
There's nothing like a mother. Nothing stronger than a mother's love. I don't always get to tell you. So let me take the time to say Happy Mother's Day.
Baby, you're the only one who'll understand me. I'm the God created just for me. Now that I'm blessed with all your babies, know you then like you do just to love me. There's nothing like a mother's,
nothing stronger than a mother's love. I don't always get to tell you, so let me take the time to say Happy Mother's Day.
take the time to say Happy Mother's Day.